இதெல்லாம் தேவையில்லையோ.
So shall we start now?
Ah, yes ma'am.
Good evening to everyone here. First of all, we apologize to you for making you waiting for a long time. Kindly forgive us. We, the management, the principal and the faculty members of Govindammal Aditanar College for Women, Tiruchendur, are very glad and proud to welcome you all for this wonderful academic program during this pleasant chill evening time. Our college is the first self-financing college in Thoothukudi district, established by Aditanar Educational Institution in 1987 with a noble motive of spreading higher education to the people of rural areas in and around Tiruchendur. It owes its origin entirely on the philanthropy of Padma Shri Dr. B. Sivandi Adityan, the illustrious son of a noble father, Mr. S.P. Adityan, who is popularly known as Sipa Aditanar, and is run under the chairmanship of Mr. S. Balasubramania Adityan. The mission of our college is to impart quality education to the women folk and make them to be self-reliant, good and useful citizens of our motherland. We have 12 UG courses, 6 PG courses, 2 research level courses and 5 certificate courses. Our esteemed institution has the academic credit of securing many university rank continuously from its establishment. So far, our students have obtained 1,297 university ranks, including 78 gold medals. We are very happy and proud to say that from the inception of our Department of English, that is UG course in 1993 and PG course in 2016, our department students have obtained 157 university ranks and 5 gold medals. We, the Department of English, feel very delighted and proud in organizing this webinar on the topic to the present since the beginning, an overview of Indian, American and English drama. It is an interesting topic each and every English literature student and scholar must come across. Keeping this in mind, we have chosen this topic for discussion in our today's webinar. Let us seek the blessings of Lord Almighty to lead us and make this academic endeavor a grand success. Welcoming is the noblest act of any function. Now I invite Dr. G. Jayalakshmi, Associate Professor of English and the coordinator of this program, to spray the sweet aroma of happiness through the words of welcome. Please, ma'am.
Good evening, everybody. I take immense pleasure in welcoming everyone to this function. First, I'd like to extend a red carpet welcome to our chief guest, Dr.U.Kethrapal, Assistant Professor, St. John's College, Palayamkottai. He consented to be the resource person for this webinar with abundant enthusiasm. On behalf of our department, I give a warm welcome to you, sir. Then I welcome our principal, who is the catalyst in our activities. Then I like to welcome our beloved HOD, Dr. Randall, who is the guiding force and a motivator for us. Then I welcome the faculty members of our college and the faculty members of other colleges. Finally, I welcome all the students who are going to have an intellectual feast today. Once again, I welcome one and all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for your warm welcome note. Now I call upon Dr. R. Andar, the head of the Department of English and the convener of this program, to introduce our honorable resource person to the August gathering.
A pleasant rainy evening, everybody. I deem it a great pleasure and privilege in introducing our dynamic resource person, Dr.U.Kethrapal, an assistant professor, Department of English, St. John's College, Palayamkottai. He obtained his doctorate in 2019 in Manormaniyam Sundaranar University. His educational qualification is MA, MPhil, PhD. The title of his PhD thesis is Commitment as Leitmotif, the Place of Mahashweta Devi and Lorraine Hansberry. I'm exhilarated to announce that he possesses additional qualification by clearing his SET examination during 2012, which was conducted by Bharatiya University. At present, 4 PhD scholars are doing their PhD under his guidance. He also guides PG students and MPhil scholars for their project and dissertation work. Regarding his career, he worked as an assistant professor in the Department of English for nearly 6 years in G. Vengadaswamy Naidu College, Koyilpatti. He has been working in St. John's College, Palayamkottai as an assistant professor in the Department of English since 2014. Altogether, he has 13 years work experience as an assistant professor. He's a multifaceted personality and he has dedicated himself in multifarious works. He acted as fine arts convener and as the coordinator of English Literary Association. He was also the coordinator of anti-ragging committee. Adding a feather to the cap, he has participated, presented, and published papers in numerous state level, national level, international level seminars and conferences. Dr. Kethrapal also acted as a resource person in many colleges in various seminars and conferences. He has the credit of organizing many seminars and conferences in his college. Such a skillful person is the resource person for our today's webinar, bearing the title To the Present Since the Beginning, an Overview of Indian, American and English Drama. The angel of luck has knocked at our door today. That's why we are gifted with an excellent resource person, Dr. Kethrapal, for our webinar. He deserves rich and bulky accolades. As the head of the department, sir, I am elated in giving a red carpet welcome to you. Thank you, everybody. Now over to Dr. C.K. Umadevi, one of the program coordinators.
Thank you so much, ma'am. We are delighted to have an eminent and intellectual personality as our resource person today. It is my great privilege to welcome our chief guest of the day, Dr. Kethrapal, Assistant Professor of English, St. John's College, Palayamkottai, to enlighten our teaching learning community with his informative speech. Please, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. I'm thankful. I'm indebted to Dr. Andal, madam, the head of the department of Govindammal College for Women. And next, the convener of the Literary Association, Dr. Jayalakshmi and Dr. C.K. Umadevi, and also Professor Sherlin for their enthusiasm in organizing such a kind of events. Welcome, ma'am. And first of all, I would like to apologize because it has been delayed due to so many other technical problems. And I would like to apologize. And it is all because of my fault that this program is delaying. Okay. Now, let me come to the topic. To the present, since the beginning, an overview of Indian, American and English drama. So first of all, what do we mean by the term drama? What do you think that drama is? Drama roots from the word dram in Greek, meaning to do, to act. And according to William J. Long, the historian, drama is an old story told in the eye of an author, and it is put into action by living a performance, as far Makesh Dattani is concerned, as if touching a live bar wire that stages a platform is. Various actors and characters are being played by the persons, the individual persons, and their utterances and their own actions and commitment to the stage. That is called this a performance. So drama is lively acting. Drama and theater, how do we classify drama and theater? Well, drama is a written text. Theater is the place where it is produced with dialogues. The director plays a major role, and drama assumes the existence of an actor who will lend his body, his voice, action, an existence for the time needed for the performance of the drama. If you, for example, take Sivaji Ganeshan playing the role of Veerapandiya Kattabomman, people ought to have thought Veerapandiya Kattabomman is Sivaji Ganeshan. That is the strength and that is the might of the actor. And it is with the sole performance of the director that and the actor that the drama gets a powerful effect and medium. How to categorize drama broadly? You can categorize drama into Eastern drama and Western drama. And Eastern drama is said to have originated in India since the very beginning of the second century BC and 10th century BC. Between 200 BC and 1000 BC. And Eastern dramatic theater is more and more dance oriented, while Western dramatic theater is more and more dialogue oriented. And Western dramatic theater said to have originated from Greece, either in India or in Greece. The very form drama that has come into existence as a result of the religious ceremonies. And in India, the dance form by Bharata Muni, the Natya Shastra, who has given his Natya Shastra. And Kautilya's Artha Shastra. And in the four Vedas, it has been prescribed, and there are many references we have on various other dramas that are the evidences that in India, the custom has originated since the second BC itself. And Natya Shastra is called as the fifth Veda. But equally, as for the Indian dramatic theater or Eastern dramatic theater is concerned, Eastern dramatic theater also includes Chinese drama as well as Japanese dramas. But then chiefly Indian drama is centered on the theoretical underpinning of Bharata Muni's Natya Shastra, and the rasa becomes the crux of everything. And the nine moods, Navarasa, they say, the dance that is given with emotions, that forms the basis of Bharata Muni's drama. And it is a theory, the Natya Shastra is a theory, and it claims for the drama a divine origin and a close connection with the sacred Vedas themselves. And the origin of Indian English drama can be traced to the ancient rules and seasonal festivities of the Vedic Aryans. Lord Indra and his councils, where drama is used as a ritual, is played as a ritual. Even the very dance form of Shiva It gives some sort of sabda and artha. But the mainstream theater equally neglects the marginalized theater. Even in the 2nd century BC onwards, when we say that Indian drama is Sanskritized, and Sanskritized or the mainstream dramatists give importance to Sanskrit dramas rather than the marginalized drama, where in marginalized section of people across the world, in Maharashtra it is called as Palol Jatra, and Tamil Nadu it is called as Pavakuthu. So many states have regional different modes of conveying things. In the East Indian drama, apart from Bharata Muni, Patanjali's Vyakarna Mahabhashya, as well as Vastayan's Kama Sutra, and Kautilya's Arthashastra, and Panini's Astabhashyam, they also play a major contribution to the Sanskrit drama. And all literature in Sanskrit is classified into drishya, that can be seen or exhibited, and sarvya, that can be heard or recited. While poetry in all forms said to fall under the latter, drama falls under the former, that is drishya, that can be seen or exhibited. And this is the origin of Sanskrit Indian or East Indian drama, which is highly, you know, dance oriented. And even today in Dattani's and in Girish Karnad's place Hayavadana, you can see, you know, people were playing the role, they were dancing and they were acting. So dance gets importance in the place of Girish Karnad. And the modern dramatists, Girish Karnad as well as Badal Sargar and Magesh Dattani, employs both the Eastern as well as the Western dramatic theater. The Western dramatic theater said to have originated in Greece. Yes, the Greek as well as the Roman classes, the Western drama, it takes its, it loses its origin in the year 5th BC, that is 500 BC. And it was a worship pattern, like in India, it was a worship pattern of the Greek god Dionysus, who is the god of wine and fertility. The first theater consisted of a group of chantless called the chorus. Even in the Western drama, that is in British drama, especially you ought to have learnt in Murder in the Cathedral of T.S. Eliot, regarding the chorus, in which, you know, the chorus comes there, augurs certain things or what is likely to happen. And in Greek event, this chorus become known as goat singers, and their chant, the goat song or tragos, is the origin of the word tragedy, from which, you know, tragedy emerges. The ceremonies honoring Dionysus evolved into a dramatic contest. Legend states that Thepsis won the first competition, and Thepsis happened to be the first actor that ever acted in the Western dramatic theater, and history still remembers him as the first actor. The term Thespian has been given to actors ever since. So the Thespian award is being given in many of the occasions. So the festivities of the early festivities of the Dionysus lasted for 5 or 6 days, where the playwright presented their plays. And the myth or the satire type of plays were the early plays, and they were acted. Some 3 or 4 actors would act right in front of the open area. And especially women even were prevented to act in the Greece dramatic theater. The first dramatic theater, you see the picture, is began as a circular, or you can call it as a semicircular area called orchestras, surrounded by a hillside on which the audience sat. Eventually, some stone seats and a stone building called skene were added. And this is the former pattern of the Greek dramatic theater. And the actors used the skene for changing masks and costumes. You can see in the front portion, in the semicircular portion, there is one room that is for, that there is a proscenium, and there is a room where they used to change their costumes. And masks were used by the early actors to portray various emotions. And painting was later used. And scenery was painted on the front. Instead of using cyclorama, in the beginning, they just used painting. And the roof was called as the God walk for actors playing gods. So the very portion, the elevated portion, is called as the God's walk, for the actors were playing the role of, you know, gods and goddesses. So the Greek drama or the Sanskrit drama were modeled on gods and goddesses, and common man did not become the center of these dramatic concepts. The idea of the mask, which is right now seen in the PowerPoint presentation, which is, stands for sorrow, happiness, drooping somebody or giggling at somebody, this sort of masks were created. Even today, people here in the southern part who are going for the Muthumarian temple not have known how, you know, people have masks, that monkey masks and various other masks. Similar masks were used in the very previous times onwards. It was the Greeks who used these masks to show the emotions. And from the Greek theater emerges the English theater as well as the American theater. They drew their origin from the Greek theater, and the Greek word mechanical devices, used mechanical devices in their productions. One such machine, one machine was called as a crank-like hoist that allowed actors to fly. And usually characters lowered by the machine represented gods come to earth to solve the problems of man. Instead of using an elevated position and coming down, jumping from there, they used some sort of a machine to pull them into air. And these sort of technical aspects were used by the traditional dramatists itself. And in Greek dramas, the chorus plays a very important part, in the early plays. The chorus, as in Sanskrit, you have the sudradhar or a string holder who manages everything. Similarly, here the chorus serves to explain the situation and to comment on the action. The chorus also interacted with the actors in the beginning. So they would ask, who is going to come? What is likely to happen? What are we expecting? Similar questions would have been asked in the very traditional form. And the Greek chorus today, how do we make use of the Greek chorus today? The Greek chorus is very still alive. That's what I said in Modern the Cathedral, you know, the Hungry Hawk, that passage would be coming. People with all their dresses would come and stand right in front of them, and they would be playing the role of auguring things in the drama. And even in most of the films, we have the use of chorus. Even in dance, when a song is being sung, the hero in, at the backdrop, you know, you have several heroines, other people dancing at the backdrop. And the chorus is remarked by many other things, and the uses are many. The Greek tragedy is considered classics of Western literature. So after this sort of festivities, they considered their gods and goddesses as, you know, classics. And they also involved in some sort of conflicts, and there arises some sort of clash among the gods because they were all ambitious and their desires of humanity. They show how useless is it is to fight fate. So no one can't fight against, you know, fate. That is the crux of early Greek tragedies. Nobody can fight against gods and goddesses. That sort of supremacy that they owed. And some of the Greek writers, the dramatists, Achilles, you ought to have known the Achilles heel. And note, he is remarkable for his majesty of his writing, the Greek trilogy, the Orestia. And then comes yet another important writer, the Sophocles, who can be ranked with Shakespeare as one of the greatest dramatists of the Greek era. His balance between the power of gods and the importance of humans created some of the strongest characters ever to walk on stage. And then Euripides emphasized human relationships and became a master of pathos. And he was the reason behind writing the Trojan women Medea. And equally, apart from Greek theater, the Roman theater also contributed much. And there also in the 6th century BC, around 100 years, later in 399 BC, Romans began performing ceremonies called lectisternisms. These ceremonies were used as a means of giving offerings to Roman gods. So in India, in Rome, as well as Greek theater, all were using theater as a means of paying the rituals. And from Greek, the genre tragedy and comedy was borrowed into Roman theater too. And I have mentioned some of the early Roman tragedies in his Pacuvius and Lucius Aquis, and as well as Seneca, which is in Italy. When we deal with the Jacobean drama, the Seneca, the place gets much important in the Roman tragedy. And the Roman comedy, as far as the comedy is concerned, that have been survived and categorized as fabula palliata, comedies based on Greek subjects. The early English plays and as well as American plays were modeled on the Greek tragedy. Similarly, you know, the Romans also borrowed the idea of Greek subjects, and later they tried to act according to their ethos. And the musical accompaniment was also used, and it was used as a simultaneous supplement to the play's dialogue. Somewhat, when somebody is dead, you know, we have a slur kind of music, a refrain is following something, and that too, you know, the music also creates an effect. As per the Aristotelian theory, the six focal points are needed, and that is being stressed by the theory, Greek theorist, you know, Aristotle. And the six elements of tragedy is put forth by Aristotle. Now I directly move into American drama. When you say American drama, the idea has been America was colonized by the Great Britain, and America was a colony. Since America was a colony, every thing was followed from the Great Britain, and some sort of difference has been created, initiated, because they wanted to produce an ethos of their nation. When the nationalistic feelings were running high, they started creating their ethos. and the early American drama happens to be, it can be dated back to 30th April of 1598 in the place called El Paso in Texas, when a comedy about soldiers on a march written by a captain, Marcos Fafen de los Godos, was performed. So it was actually a Spanish drama, a Spanish comedy, and that was acted by the Dutch people, and that was the first drama to be acted in the American theater. And the next American play happens to be by a landowner, William Darby, in his E Bear and E Cub, the first recorded play in English in America. This is being said by one critic or a critical historian of the American drama, Mr. Magill. But the first American drama to be acted on the stage happens to be by Arthur Hobson Quinn, and he performed that drama on the stage in the theater in Philadelphia in the year 1767. So in the first American play was staged only in the 18th century in the American drama, and much of the ideas were borrowed from England, and especially Shakespearean plays as well as religious plays were enacted in America, and they also used music to enhance drama. Meanwhile, civil war broke out in America that prevented some of the activities in drama. And as a result of the civil war, there was for a particular period of time, it was stopped. But then after the breaking out of the civil war, there were prohibitions by the Continental Congress in 1774. And this did not prevent theater entirely. And patriotic plays were thriving in America. Characters frequently, you know, military and political figures of the time taken from real life were enacted. Thus, drama began as a theater movement in America as a result of nationalistic feeling. Dunlap, a man of varied interest, was called the Samuel Janssen of the late 18th century and the early 19th century of the American stage. His first chronicle of the American stage stands out as a history of American theater. Drama criticism had begun, and Dunlap records the formation of groups that gathered to support and stimulate interest in theater by reviews in the magazines. So people started writing reviews on the drama that made the medium in an effective manner. So Americans during the early 19th century were enjoying the same kind of melodramatic farce that was popular on English stage. The same kind of drama that were hailed in Great Britain was also hailed here. Meanwhile, drama had its turn. It followed so many patterns. It underwent so many movements. From naturalism, realism, expressionism, existentialism, and so many other philosophical school of thought also revolutionized the concept of drama. If a wall is needed, some sort of a character was placed right in front of the stage, standing like a wall. And or physically they have to raise a barrier. Two options they had. Some sort of symbols were used in drama, and these symbols changed the very paraphernalia of the theater of the 19th century. And during the 19th century in England, Henrik Ibsen marked the very beginning beginning of a new movement called domestic realism. So this concept of naturalism was propounded by one Emily Zola, and this Henrik Ibsen considered that it is somewhat not natural, and the theme were always, you know, talking about gods and goddesses or kings and queens. That forms the very basis of the 19th century. Before 19th century, you know, much of the things were dealt by, you know, the themes were dealt with the idea of royal people in mind. So ordinary people, the rustic life was not considered, and that might be the reason because of the French Revolution too. So after the French Revolution, democracy has been instilled in all the theater, all the schools, and that formed the basis of so many other things. And in Henrik Ibsen's Doll's House and in The Enemy of the People, common man becomes the subject, common themes becomes the social issue becomes the issue. In Doll's House, you know, it was a quarrel between the husband and wife, how the wife acted and how the husband acted, how those repercussions happened in the family. That was for the first time stressed by Henrik Ibsen, and that marked its repercussions in the American drama too. And it masked the very movement called realism. And people considered to portray real life situations in dramatic events. So realism is nothing but focusing the very real life itself, because in life we suffer a lot. So far we have seen, you know, fancies, fantasies, or mystery plays, or miracle plays. For the first time, you know, Henrik Ibsen marked that beginning, and that followed for another 10 to 20 years. What Arthur Miller wrote in his A Death of a Salesman. It is a death of a father, and a failed father. So that also, when people started about talking about hope and all that, Arthur Miller talked about, for the first time, he talked about the death of a father. So we consider that as something intruding or something pessimistic in nature. But what Arthur Miller did was that he projected the failed father, because that was the real life incident that happened in the American scene, or not only in American scene, in the entire America and wherever we went, you know, people were failing in their career options. And that was focused in his in Arthur Miller's following Henrik Ibsen. And the very next philosophical school is expressionism, that oozes from the absurd philosophy also. Albert Camus published his Myth of Sisyphus, in which, you know, life becomes meaningless, life becomes absurd. And there is no purpose in meaning, there is no nothing in life. That is the concept. And those cues are being picked up by certain other philosophical movement. And as a result of the publication of that, two things happened. One is expressionism, that the other one is absurd drama. And people like Eugene O'Neill, though a black American, you know, he could change the entire scene of America. And in his Harry Ape, he, for the first time, he included also the claustrophobic experiences, having the psychological aspects, dealing with the mind. since the father of psychology happens to be Freud, the development of all these schools of thoughts have been taken into drama, and that has been acted out in all the axioms. And he is generally considered as the first important figure in the American drama, though so many dramatists were already there. He introduced into American drama the techniques of realism earlier associated with Ibsen, Strindberg, and Chekhov from Russian section. And American drama before O'Neill tended to be mild and sentimental, rarely questioning the life and almost never challenging the accepted traditions of the time. It consisted mostly of shows and spectacles staged by special effects that dazzled the audience, that thrilled the audience. But for the first time, you know, these things have been broken by Eugene O'Neill, and he stands as an iconoclast in the history of American drama. Then we have Tennessee Williams. His own glass menagerie talks about the social problem. What are all the problems that happen in the life of an abandoned family? And that forms the crux, and that gives the 19th century gives some sort of scope for family to be treated. And family issues were treated by, and the psychological aspects of the individual characters were taken into account, and they were given much importance in America. And then we have the campus novels, and which also reflected in, you know, enacting dramas in schools as well as in colleges. When the mainstream theater goes on like this, there happened to be another theater movement, the neglected theater movement. Even in India, there we have a neglected theater movement called as IPTA, Indian People's Theater Association, or the Theater of Roots, which deals with the themes of the marginalized. Similarly, in America in the 1960s, witnessed these sort of black arts movement mooted by the Harlem Renaissance and the contributions of the W.B. Du Bois and the Harlem Renaissance. So many people were asking for, demanding for their life, because in the 19th century too, Abraham Lincoln gave much hope for the Americans claiming the emancipation, or signing the Emancipation Act, that also gave provision to the black people to raise their voice in the platform. And the Black Arts Movement, BAM, was an Afro-American led art movement active during the 1960s and the 1970s. Through their activism and art, Black Arts Movement created new cultural institutions and conveyed a message of black pride. So black aestheticism was developing in America as a result of this black movement. So people were never looking at you know, black people in that manner, and their accepted opinions or their own ideologies were neglected. But this Harlem Renaissance mooted all the blacks as an eye opener. And that forms a center of a hub, which is called as Black Arts Movement. In that movement, we have Amiri Baraka, Jed Bullins, as well as, you know, Lorraine Hansberry in it. They were claiming for their people equal rights through drama. And so many repercussions or problems were taken, and the racial cues and questions, the ghetto life and the labor problems, and the inhuman treatment meted out, and how they were blacks were prevented from education, those things were all questioned by this movement. And that movement marked the beginning of a very new thing altogether in the 19th, at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the very 20th century. And when this goes like that, the mainstream was obsessed with the absurd drama, and people like Edward Albee, they were started creating, focusing, portraying life as it is, and they were not questioning, they were not focusing on certain issues of human life. Rather, you know, they tried to focus people as they are, existentialism, or the survival becomes a central theme, and they show the people as they wish to live life, not any kind of moral or discipline things that comes in their life. And these people, these absurdist dramas, especially his zoo story, conveys some sort of a sense of meaningless, or it may be people who believe or who have their faith on moral would think that it is some sort of vagueness. But he was focusing that the individual mind of the characters who are acting out, they were indulging in eat and read, drink and be merry, for tomorrow you may die. And they indulge in all pleasures of life as they felt they led a life of recklessness. And that formed the very theme of the absurd dramatist. And that the absurd dramatist does not look life something as, you know, meaningful. Rather, they try to portray characters as it is. The existentialism got reflected in the 21st century, the end of the 20th century, as well as the 21st century. And this is what is called as, you know, American, the dramatic world is. And next, I would like to come to British drama. The British drama, British borrowed the ideology, Western dramatic theater borrowed the ideology from Greece only. And as early as 1066, the Norse, you ought to have heard about the stories while they were at, sailing on the seafaring people. After the Norman conquest, people in the 1660s, they had their worship called as the Norse worship, and for which, you know, so many stories as well as drama has been used. And the early plays, then in the medieval period, the English stage or the English drama had its shift. The first thing plays to be enacted in the English was called as, you know, mystery plays and the miracle plays. Especially they were borrowed from Latin as well as, you know, the Greek plays. They were enacted, they were acting out in Latin, and later translations were given in churches, you know, to say which is good or which what is bad. In Dr. Faustus, in Christopher Marlowe's Faustus, you can witness this kind of the oscillation between the good and the bad. The church in every evening, Sunday evening, in the church, they used to enact so many things in as a result of the mystery plays and miracle plays. And pastors played the role, and women were prevented from acting in stage. And the early miracle play in England was Ludus Sante di Catharina, because, you know, the very titles have the Latin names, and that forms the beginning of drama in England. And mystery plays focused on the representation of Bible stories in churches as tableau with accompanying antiphonal song. They developed from the 10th century to the 16th century, reaching the height of the popularity in the 15th century before being rendered obsolete to the rise of professional theater. The miracle play attracted so many people and increased its popularity. After the miracle plays move outside the church, the secular organizations or town guilds began to take responsibility in its production. So, theater was the first play. Mystery plays were the hub of the development of drama in Great Britain. And a few changes happened in mystery plays, and those things were enacted in the outside by the people who are playing a very important role, that is the nobles. And miracle plays, it is a dramatization of the personified abstraction, generally vice against virtue. In these plays, the characters were allegorically personified, such as death, sin, good and bad angel, seven deadly sins, etc. The purpose of this drama was didactic, to give moral lesson to the audience. So the morality plays generally ended with the virtue win against all the evils. And then came from the inspiration of mystery and miracles play, the artistic movement period was beginning in England. During this period, English drama was influenced by classical drama. The first comedy happens to be Rolf Royster Doister, written by Nicholas Woodall on 1556, and the first tragedy happens to be Gobduck. So since it was borrowed from the Greek tradition, you have the comedy as well as the tragedy in British drama. And next, Thomas Sackville and Thomas Norton around 1562. After this era, the English drama developed gradually into a regular form of drama which flourishes during the Renaissance period, the Elizabethan reign, and which is known till today, because in Elizabethan period we have Shakespeare as well as the university works, and you know, nearly, you know, 38 plays have been written by Shakespeare, and you can divide the plays into, you know, so many plays, comedies and tragedies, history plays, then problem plays and bitter comedies. You know, so many divisions of drama can be. When the Greeks used semicircle theater, here, you know, the hexagonal type of theater was used, and as then, you know, scenic features and scenic divisions were done by so many partitions of the stages in the Shakespearean era. And Shakespeare can be called, still even today, he is called as the father of, you know, English drama, since because of his commitment to drama, and his character holds up to nature, mirror up to nature. And the other important figures are the university wits, especially, you know, Christopher Marlowe, who excelled, you know, he would have been excelling Shakespeare if he had lived after that. And Christopher Marlowe is Dr. Faustus. Even today, which we have in syllabus, you know, talks about the human antagonistic feeling, how human beings are over ambitious in life. Dr. Faustus having a thirst for knowledge, having a thirst for everything, to achieve everything, the passions of life, that formed the basis of Christopher Marlowe's drama, and that focused on how the fall of a great man would be. And that forms the passion or the central theme of so many other dramas and dramatists also. And the contemporaries of Shakespeare, John Fletcher and Beaumont, they also played their role. And Ben Jonson, then next came the Jacobean theater, where, you know, the idea was borrowed from Italy, and people had some sort of horror towards bloodshed, and some sort of rugged kind of feeling they had, and they wanted to see some sort of bloodshed upon theater, because their own catharsis, that is evoking pity and fear, that has to be aroused, and the people, you know, started having some sort of vulgarity, and the Jacobean stage becomes some sort of vulgar, and we see, you know, we witness so many bloodshed and horror in such type of, you know, Jacobean theatres. And Ben Jonson's satirical plays were particularly, you know, Walpone, the Alchemist, as well as, you know, the Bartholomew Fair, and Thomas Kidd's The White Devil was modeled upon this Italian ideology and the horror and bloodshed. And John Webster's The White Devil, as well as Thomas Kidd's plays, the Spanish tragedy, they talked about all sorts of vengeance, or vengeance being the center of the theme. And in the 17th and 18th century, you can because of the Puritan rule, there was the closure of theatres. The London theatres were all closed, the Ross, and so many other theatres which were gaining importance were closed down. And after, only during the Restoration period, they gave much importance to comedy, as well as, you know, love became the central theme, and recreation became the central theme. And in this era, you cannot omit Dryden, the classist, the neoclassist, you know, who's all for love, which dealt with, you know, the theme of love, how Antony had a curiosity of love over Cleopatra. And it is the celebration of love, and the Augustan mood, the Augustan temperament of living a loose life, that was also focused in the place of the Augustan world. And then, as I said, the existentialism, the absurdism, played its major role in the 20th century. Harold Pinter, whose birthday party, you know, he dealt with some sort of, not with moral discipline, but he focused life as it is. People started living on their own images, and those were all being portrayed by Harold Pinter, Andrew Lloyd Webber, Brian Friel, Carlyle Churchill, and Samuel Beckett. And meanwhile, you cannot omit, you know, Samuel Beckett, because, you know, he also was influenced by Albert Camus' The Myth of Sisyphus, and his Waiting for Godot is a play which does not have any meaning at all. That is questioning what life itself is and what waiting itself is. And Pozo and Lucky, they were waiting for somebody else. They do not know whom they are waiting. But they have been just to pass the while away the time, they hanged themselves. And it also, you know, focuses about the uncertainty of human life and human beings not having any faith at all. That the foolishness of absurdism and the nature of the characters are portrayed as such, and the existential questions were asked, and the existentialism forms the central thesis of the 20th century British drama. And this has given way for many other things. And as I mentioned, realism and myth, Sigmund Freud and Carl Jung, that influenced these kind of trend movements, you know, dominated the entire scene of British, American, as well as the Indian theater. Meanwhile, we have, after the Henrik Ibsen, as I said in the description of the American drama, Henrik Ibsen marked the beginning of a very new, the Norwegian dramatist marked the very beginning of a new era, and out of which, you know, John Galsworthy in his The Strife as well as The Silver Box talks about, you know, social issues. His own The Strife is an outcome of a company which indulges in some sort of autocracy. The board decides against, you know, the whims and fancies of laborers working there. The bourgeois class was playing its role. And meanwhile, you know, America witnessed the upsurge of Karl Marx's, the publication of those theories too. And that also got impact has got in the 19th century as well as in the 20th century. And the result of communism, there was an upsurge of right-wing and left-wing politics that got entry into the place of England. And The Strife is a voice or a protest of the laborers. The Trinetha factory is the root cause of all problems. And in Strife, you know, Lars, you can see that which echoes, you know, Oliver Goldsmith's life grinds the laws grind the poor and rich men rule the law, which is the crux of Oliver Goldsmith's The Deserted Village. And that got its place there in The Silver Box by John Galsworthy, because, you know, here the charge, actually, you know, the wealthier person has stolen the silver box, but the charge a laborer, a worker. And the judge also consented, though knowing the facts, you know, he also gave punishment to the laborer. And this forms the basis that ordinary people are becoming the center in the 19th century as a result of the rise of the French Revolution, as well as the communism, the rise of communism, as well as the philosophical movements and philosophical schools. And meanwhile, when in realism, people got focused on the real life situations, people were suffering, and it meant a very direct observation of human behavior, where place is the past mostly used mythological or stereotypical characters. Now they involved in the lower class, the poor, the rich, they involved in all sort of real things were portrayed in the realism. And out of communist upsurge, we have got one movement called social realism. And social realism is, you know, nothing but taking a political standpoint. The writers, they have some sort of conscience in them. And as a result of them, you know, they tried to form a political side with the oppressed. And this forms the very basic of the G.B. Shaw's play. These plays can be called as, you know, propagandist plays in the 20th, beginning of the 20th century. His own apple cart is a master craftsmanship, but it was asking about, it was questioning about the prime minister, the aristocracy, or people who are in power. And his own celebration of the flower girl, Liza, in taking the allusion from the Greek theater, Aphrodite, he tries to inbuilt his own character or his own sensibility or his own commitment towards bringing up or raising people from the local standards. And that is the commitment of, you know, social realism as such. And the absurdist dramas, as I mentioned, you know, this philosophical school had its repercussions in the in England, and people like Harold Pinter, you know, Samuel Beckett, they were dealing with absurdism as such. And the very next philosophical movement in that influenced drama field is Dadaism, that included, you know, writing, painting and poetry as well as theater. Many Dadaists wrote manifestos detailing their beliefs, which normally outlined their disgust in colonialism and nationalism, and tried to be opposite to the current aesthetics and values because of the avant-garde movements or artist responses. And the next philosophical school to him to have his impact is, you know, surrealism. It developed the physicality of theater and downplayed words, hoping to influence its audience through action. Other common characteristics of surreal plays are unexpected comparisons and surprise. The most famous British playwright in the 20th, 20s, the surrealist style is, you know, Samuel Beckett. Samuel Beckett can also be called as a surrealist, you know, dramatist. And expressionism also had its impact. The movement which had been borrowed from German, or it was coined in Germany. Expressionism had two distinct branches. The branches had characters speaking in short, direct sentences or in long lyrical expanses. This type of theater usually did not name the characters and spend much time lamenting the present and warning against the future. Spiritual awakenings and episodic structures were also fairly common during these kind of in this expressionist movement. So far, people were attached towards theater from the very tradition, traditional theater. People were involved in, they were emotionally involving themselves in drama. And for the first time, you know, that was broken by Bertolt Brecht. Because he propounded the epic theater, and he wanted to inform his audience about, you know, so many things. And he rejected all the realistic jargons of the realistic theater. And he found that such plays were too picture perfect. And the epic theater is based on Greek epic poetry. There are dramatic illusions such as stark, harsh lighting, blank stages, placards announcing changes of scenes, bands playing, because, you know, people stick on to the unity of time, place and action. And for the first time, you know, these things were broken. Even by Dryden, you know, when Dryden stressed unity of action alone, the later dramatists, you know, they also, you know, their action was also, you know, dethroned. And bands playing, music on stage and long discomforting pauses were also, you know, used. Brecht believed that drama should be made within its audience, and he thought that epic theater drama would reinforce the realities that people were facing rather than challenge them. And epic theater helped to preserve the social issues they portrayed. The mother courage and her children is a best example of you know, the portrayal of the social portrayal of the mother as such. And now I would like to throw light upon the Indian theater. The Indian theater, as I said, had its beginning in the Natya Shastra. That is called as the fifth Veda. People went to Lord Brahma and asked for aesthetic theater, and Brahma was kind enough to give, and Indra and all the people, you know, they rejoiced, and that happened to be the fifth Veda. And according to Sanskrit theater, which began in the second BC itself, second century BC itself, this Sanskrit drama grows around, you know, three primary constituents, namely vastu, plot, and neta, hero, and rasa, sentiment. The plot could be either principal, adhikarika, or accessory, prasangika. The former concerns the primary characters of the theme and pervades the entire play. The latter serves to further and supplement the main topic and relates to subordinate characters other than the chief ones. This is further divided into banner, pataka, and incident, pakari. As I said, you know, the Sanskrit drama is the outcome of ritual, and it is an outcome of the dance. So many emotions, the rasa, formed the basis of Eastern theater. Till 1000 BC, you can divide India into ancient, medieval, and modern dramas. And the ancient drama happens to be, you know, Sanskrit drama. And there was a kind of nationalistic feeling. And this nationalistic feeling is attributed because even in the medieval as well as the modern plays, this faith in Sanskrit drama or Sanskritization is as a result of giving one or forming a kind of nationalistic feeling in India. And the medieval period can be dated from, you know, 1000 BC to the present, and the modern drama can be placed from, you know, 1900s to the that is 19th century to the 21st century. And the first play to be written in Sanskrit happened to be, you know, Kalidasa's Sakuntalam. And Kalidasa's Sakuntalam was translated in so many other regional languages. And around, you know, 1000 BCs and in the 17th century too, this play was published, and this got the attention of so many people. And there was equally, you know, folk theatres and other regional theatres in India in the medieval period. And till the medieval period, drama was a place, or it was a hub of, you know, only the upper class people. And only during the entry of British under the rule of the East India Company, the alley playhouses were set up in Calcutta. In 1775 was the Calcutta Theatre, then the Kaurangi Theatre in 1833, and the Sans Souci Theatre in 1839 were patronized by only colonial officials. And even historians like Hemendranath Das Gupta, in his four volume, and Indian stage, published in Calcutta between 1944 and 1946, and Ramanlal Kanayalal, the Indian theatre did not acknowledge the presence of other theatre performance in India. And many of the later historians of Indian theatre written after the independence continued to emphasize the lasting importance of Sanskrit theatre on the Indian theatre, and continued to many actors did not have a sense of Western forms of theatre. So the Sanskrit drama that was carried over till the present era. So even after independence, you know, people started only thinking about, you know, Sanskritization because of the philanthropists who popularized the dramatic form. And the folk tradition, you know, in each and every state, in Tamil Nadu as well as Pavakutu, in Kerala as Kathakali, in Maharashtra as Jatra, and in Punjab and in other Uttar Pradesh as Palol, you know, these regional dramas were also being played, but they were neglected because by the mainstream writers. And even in here, you know, you have the Theatre of Roots and IPTA, Indian People's Theatre Association, which talks about the marginalized people and their own concerns. And here, you know, Badal Sargar, who formed the third theatre, can also be taken into account. Badal Sargar and Vijay Tendulkar, Maga Shweta Devi cannot be forgotten in the Indian scene, because they were also talking about the issues that were prevailing in India as a result of exotic things. You know, they also talked about the European theatres or European theatres which were popular in so many theories. Also, you know, it had its impact upon, you know, India, and people like Girish Karnad, Magesh Dattani, as well as Badal Sargar, Vijay Tendulkar, they also talked about Kanyadan, talks about, you know, the social problems and the Tale Danta of Girish Karnad talks about the communal racial tensions that were prevailing in the India, even in the ancient period and in the medieval period. And Maga Shweta Devi, you know, breaks the as a revisionist of history. She reconsiders all the grand narratives, meta narratives, throwing everything into, you know, pieces. The mainstream theater, she questions, you know, all the very pompous nature of the Sanskrit theater and breaks the traditions and everything in her text. Though many of the women writers were not allowed to write or act in terms of you have to accept that, you know, Indian theater was the first theater to allow women to act, because in Natya Shastra, in Bharatanatyam, you know, women acted roles. The early, you know, Sanskrit, the early Sanskrit writers happened to be, you know, Kalidasa, Bhavabhuti, and Bhavabhuti, as well as, you know, Habib Tanvir, you know, they also played their role. And only in the modern context, you know, women started coming into entry. During the medieval period, we don't have any kind of, you know, women playwrights or women playing their roles as such. Only in the modern era, after independence, people started women playwrights like Poyil's Sen Gupta, G. N. Devi, Magashweta Devi, and Manjula Padmanathan in the present, you know, they happen to come to limelight. And even today, you know, Magashweta's plays have not been popularized because of their nature of claiming rights for the marginalized section of people. And Magashweta Devi in her five plays has totally, you know, dismantled the theories and conventions established by the traditional theatre and all the norms. And she has used very simple theatre, and the Theatre of Roots or the ITPA used, you know, very small theatre. The gigantic lights and that formed the Western concepts have not been taken into account, and very simple light settings and cyclorama are people, you know, played the same characters and they were all, you know, used to bring into limelight their social issues, their commitment towards society. So they will, the social realists like Mahashweta Devi and all the others were all totally, you know, making or hacking the Indian scene in the movement called IPTA or Theater of Roots. And in the present era, Manjula Padmanabhan plays her major role. She questions, you know, what happens in an apartment? How, you know, in a metropolitan city, you know, people are not focusing on the issues of others. What happens in the apartment that they hear some sort of a noise, and even in the lights out and in the harvest, she talks about the colonial issues. She questions and challenges the axioms of the first world nations and the second world nations. And such a kind of writer is very hard to find. In her lights out too, you know, the social problem is being discussed and nobody in the apartment is ready to open their mouth against, you know, these sort of issues. And such a kind of a thing, you know, only in the post-independent era that women have started surfacing in writing, you know, plays. Earlier, you know, it was a dark thing that women were never allowed to write, you know, in the Indian subcontinent. And as such, you know, playwright Girish Karnad, he uses both the modern concepts as well as the traditional Sanskrit forms. He uses both the myth as well as, you know, takes cues from the folk theater too. Because now, it after independence only, there is some sort of, you know, emergence of the play drama world that deals with the social issues comes into limelight. And in his the Hayavadana also, you know, you can see Padmini as a feministic character, true to her types, true to her senses. And that forms that, you know, he borrows ideas even from the Western theater and tries to infuse in the readers, you know. Earlier, you know, Tagore, when he started writing, he was writing about, you know, only in the Western context or in the Western model. Though he dealt with some sort of social issues in his plays and some sort of existentialism in his post office too, he has not given some sort of aesthetic sensibility towards it, because he was trying to formulate in the earlier period, he was trying to formulate only in the stepping into the shoes of the Western elements. But people like Girish Karnad, bringing in the modern values as well as the questions of the hours have been questioned in this place. And people like Magesh Dattani is efficient in the Indian theatre, is efficient in using the Western theatrical elements and the Eastern theatrical elements, the dance as well as, you know, the lightings, the different kind of stages that is used in his Tara as well as in so many other plays, in his play that deals with in his play which deals with the communal riots of the Hindu-Muslim conflicts, that also formed the basis of his very important play. And in which, you know, there was a ramp and masks were also employed by, you know, Magesh Dattani in his plays. Since the very beginning, the mask was used, and that mask was also reused by Magesh Dattani, but with later, you know, some sort of a pulpit-like thing, some sort of a gallery was used by Magesh Dattani. He was concentrating, mingling up both the past and the present, the tradition and the modern, to focus on, throw into light the Indian themes. And his own Tara is a question of the girl, you know, the society was always preferring men, and they were preferring only, you know, men, and this woman is dislodged from the society when the third leg, right, was much of the nerves were running from the woman's, you know, the girl's leg. Her mother, you know, preferred, and the father was also, you know, silent, and the grandfather was able to do so many things. And as a politician, you know, he can influence so many things, and that sort of social frivolities and social cues were questioned by so many people. And I hope so that this drama, the information that I have given would be ample. And to wind up with, you know, people like Mohan Rakesh in the Hindi theater, and as well as people like Manjuna Padmanabhan, Magesh Dattani, people like Girish Karnad, they have all brought into limelight the problems of the Indian panorama in their works. And thank you, thanks a lot for giving me an opportunity to share my thought in this topics.
Sir, wonderful, sir. Thank you very much. Very nice. Thank you, were captivated by your wonderful speech, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much for your enriching and informative speech on the origin and growth of Indian, American and British drama. Hope you all would have enriched your knowledge on this field by the literary feast given by him. Once again, I extend my heartfelt thanks to you, sir. Now, it is the time for question answer session. Dear participants, now you can post your questions in the YouTube chat box and your queries will be answered. After the question answer session, the feedback link for the certificate will be posted in the YouTube chat box and also in the comment box and description box.
There are some questions, sir. Yes. In the comments, there are some questions that have been given. In which year drama started? That's the question, sir.
See, you cannot jot down when drama started. When, if you are asking about Eastern Indian dramatic theater, it is in the 200 BC, around 200 BC. In even in the Rig, Yajur and Sama, Atharvana, Vedas, you have references that. So, and in Paninis and Kautilyas, Arthashastras, in Arthashastra, you have so many evidences of you know, so many drama have been performed as a kind of, you know, dance form. That is the beginning of early drama in as far the East Indian drama is concerned.
Okay,
but in the medieval time, only during the 17th century, you have references that the Kalidasa Sakuntalam was published, right, as a book.
Shall I read the next question, sir?
Yes, ma'am.
What is the basic difference between Indian drama and European drama?
The basic difference is that Indian drama is more and more dance oriented, European drama is more and more dialogue oriented. But now we have a combination of both, can be seen in the Indian drama. That's why I mentioned, you know, in Hayavadana, it happens to be, you know, people, Kapila and Devadatta, they used to dance. It was in dance, you know, they performed everything. So the early Sanskrit form as well as the Indian theater, the mainstream theater followed some sort of dance forms in their drama. Whereas in Western theater, you have the dialogue form. Here and there, in some of the plays, you ought to have had some sort of music playing, some sort of ball movements. But other than that, you know, dance form is used in Indian and dialogue-oriented is form in followed in Western drama.
Okay, sir, the next question. In olden days, they did not have costumes and masks. In which age plays were acted with costumes and masks?
Costumes, as for the Greek theatre is concerned, you know, they have used masks very earlier in the Greek theatre itself. That was why, you know, I said in the festivities also they have used, you know, masks traditionally. But only during the period of Shakespeare, in the Elizabethan era in England, masks and costumes were used. Before that, masks was used as a kind of, you know, painting, which I showed in my PPT. So mask was, they used some sort of paintings in their faces, and that was the early mask that was used in the form of a painting. But later, you know, only during the Elizabethan era that you have costumes. Even male actors wearing women's costumes came right in front of the actors and acted. And boys were trained to sing in female voices too, with some sort of raza and bhavas.
Another question, sir. The role of women in Indian and English drama.
That was what I was telling. The Indian dramatic theater neglected women. Only after independence, we have a few writers. And even, you know, people like Mahashweta Devi has not brought into limelight. After, you know, getting the Jnanapith Award for literature also, you know, her own, though we have in academia some sort of text of her, in the mainstream theater, she was not celebrated. And now only, you know, we have Manjula Padmanathan and Poyil and Selin Gupta dealing with some sort of problems, because it was all hard for women to deal with, to talk about, you know, social issues. And even in the European context, you cannot, you know, see any sort of women dramatist till the 18th century. Even, you know, voting rights were, they were forbidden from voting rights were after the suffragette movement and all that. Only after the upsurge of 19th century, only that we have a few, you know, one or two women dramatists. And even in the American theater, only in the after the black coat movements and all that, women writers have come up to the front. People like Lorraine Hansberry, Gloria Naylor, and all that, dealing with African themes.
There are a few more questions there. Next question is, what is the interlude and how was it played?
Interlude is to reduce the tension in a play. Maybe in a tragedy, if it goes very serious, we have some sort of an interlude to evoke some to break the very seriousness of the play. In modern, in the cathedral too, you have so many interlude, and in the interlude there was a sermon, a Christmas speech was given by the parson in modern, in the cathedral. Generally, you know, an interlude is used to reduce the tension in the play.
Okay, so there is another interesting question. Why the Indian dramatists are not recognized as the British dramatists?
See, who has to give recognition? In the democratic setup, you know, even every drama becomes getting the attraction. But if you want some sort of an official forum to recognize, all are in the hands of the Western impact. But nowadays, you know, even in social media, some sort of a problem is getting. When somebody, you know, got a pizza, that is being dramatized and it is given in the social media, and immediately it becomes viral and it gets the attention. So every day, you are now, you know, media is playing a huge role in playing the drama. But no official forum will be there to celebrate Indians, because they have their own politics, the colonial vengeance. And even too in India, in the medieval period, a play that was initiated talking about the tree plantation workers was forbidden, and it was considered as a seducing agent, and it was put to an end because it talked about the white supremacy. And that is the nature of the colonial people. The colonial vengeance is playing its role, even in Africa or in the third world countries. Everywhere you can find this.
Thank you, sir. There are no other questions.
Thank you, ma'am.
I have read all the questions in the chat box.
Now the question and answer session comes to an end. Dear participants, the feedback link is available in the chat box, comment box, and also in the description box. Fill it out promptly without any mistake. You will receive the e-certificate in your registered mail ID within a week. Remember, the feedback link will be active only for 1 hour. Thank you is a word when it is said with whole heart and soul. It radiates peace, love, and harmony all around us. Now it is the time for showing our gratitude to all the people who have served and involved directly or indirectly for the successful completion of this academic endeavor. Here comes Mrs. P. Serin Satya, Assistant Professor and Organizing Secretary of this webinar, to express her words of gratitude.
Good evening, everyone. Showing gratitude is one of the simplest yet most powerful things we can do for each other, says Randy Parsh. It's my immense pleasure and privilege to propose the oath of thanks as an organizing secretary and assistant professor of English on this August occasion. This is the day that the Lord has made. First of all, I thank the Almighty God for making this webinar a grand success with his omnipresence. Then I thank the college management for rendering this wonderful opportunity to organize a webinar on to the present since the beginning, an overview of Indian, American, and English drama. I express my gratitude to the resource person, Dr.U.Kethrapal, Assistant Professor of English from St. John's College, Palayamkottai, for his fabulous presentation. I feel proud to have a resource person from the college in which I am doing my research. Thank you very much, sir, for your thought-provoking presentation. I thank our principal and patron, Dr. P. Jayanti, for her encouragement and support. I am grateful to our convener and head of the department, Dr. R. Ondal, for her guidance, interest, and support. I thank our program coordinators, Dr. G. Jayalakshmi and Dr. C. K. Umadevi, for their efforts, interest, and encouragement. I thank our co-organizer, Dr. M. Tangeshwari, for designing the certificate. Then I thank Mrs. J. U. Gayatri for her help in technical side. I also thank my colleagues and other helping hands. I extend my thanks to the participants from various institutions. Once again, I thank you all.
Thank you all. Let's wind up this program now. We shall meet very soon in our next program. Thank you once again. Thank you all.